So let me first introduce myself. My name is Gerd Ingold. I'm a theoretical physicist from the University of Augsburg. I got introduced to Python almost 15 years ago by a graduate student, whom I'm very grateful to, because nowadays I'm using Python for almost everything I'm doing, scientific work, database work, web frameworks, and whatsoever. So Python is really a platform which you can use for almost every task in computing. And today I'll tell you about NumPy arrays, at least on the introductory level, which is something which you'll need whenever you do scientific work in Python. Now, having introduced myself a little, I would like to know a little bit more about you. I saw some of the faces this morning in the tutorial. Who has been in the tutorial this morning? Almost everybody, so probably basically know everything which was taught this morning. I will come back to a few points during this tutorial, because such a tutorial usually is not enough to really learn things in detail. Who has heard about Python for the first time, or has been using Python for the first time this morning? Okay, great. So it's nice that you came here, and I hope that after this tutorial you're convinced that Python is really useful for your work. How many of you are, let's say, natural scientists, engineers? Quite a few. But probably usually there are some people from, there's somebody from humanities? Yeah? Okay. Yeah. Somebody else outside the natural sciences engineering? Okay, even for these people, I can be very useful, for example, in image processing. We'll come to that maybe through the tutorial. Important point, please interrupt me if you have any questions. Interrupt me right away. I have a certain amount of material prepared for this afternoon. If I don't finish, it's not so important. The important point is that you profit from what I'm teaching, so please interrupt me. My experience from teaching is that if somebody of you asks a question, it's very likely that somebody else wanted to ask the same question but simply didn't dare to ask. So you do yourself a favor and you do others a favor, so please feel free to interrupt me at any time. Now, we'll have a presentation which you'll find online, but there's also a Jupyter notebook. This one here. This one here. Now, who hasn't installed this notebook yet? Okay, there are quite a few. I'll say something about that in a minute. Who does not have a Python NumPy installation? Everybody? Okay, so there's Michael who is going to help. I've brought the Anaconda distribution, which I would recommend to everybody doing scientific work on these USB sticks. It's a lot of material to download. So what you do on this USB stick, you just go to the directory depending on the operating system. This is Linux, Mac, or Windows. And then you go to 32-bit or 64-bit, depending on your machine, and you should be able to install it, otherwise Michael's going to help you. About the Jupyter notebook, I think it's important that you are able to follow what I'm doing here in the notebook. So you should, if possible, download it. If it's not possible for some reason, just try to team up with a neighbor, so at least two of you can share working on one notebook, and otherwise you don't profit as much as possible. So how do you get the notebook? Well, one thing you can do is you can go to the program of this conference. You probably know this page. So you go to EuroSciPy.org 2017 to the program, and on this program page you have the installation instructions for tutorials. And if you go there, you should see this page here, and if you scroll a little bit down, you have this section on NumPy, And all the way down here, there's this link to the notebook which I'm going to use in the exercises. So you just click on it, get the notebook, and then with the right click, you should be able to save this page. This might look different on your operating system. You should be able to download this Jupyter notebook and hopefully load it and when the Jupyter notebook program. Does everybody who hasn't downloaded the notebook yet able to get to this page? Just let me know if there's any problem. I'll give you a couple of minutes to download the notebook. I mean, if there's a problem with the Wi-Fi and you're unable to download the notebook, just keep up with the neighbor and So are you all able to access the notebook or is there a problem somewhere? The notebook is very small actually, but it's unfortunate. I mean, otherwise, if your neighbor has the notebook, just team up and. I mean, actually, if you're working in a team, that might even be better because you can discuss possible solutions. You might have ideas, sharing ideas when trying to code. This is not a bad idea. So, is everybody more or less in a situation that we can get started, or do we need more time? Usually nobody's answering to a question, so I assume you're ready. Okay, let's... No, you're not ready. So what's the problem? And you're still installing the other pointer. This takes some time, because this is the hard one still using the notebook.
Oh, yeah, just a notebook. The notebook? Just give it.
So, Michael will be passing around the USB stick with the notebook. I suggest that.
Just pass it on. Just pass it.
Could you check? This just takes time,
but maybe you can pair up for the moment.
But this should work. Okay, I think we should get started. And please, if you still have a problem, wave your hand and we'll look out for you. Okay, there's one problem more. And then I think we'll get this message. Okay. So, in order to get the notebook running, what you need to do, depending on your operating system, you need to start the Jupyter notebook. The Jupyter notebook will bring up a page on your internet browser, which should look like this. So what you do is, if you're Linux, you open a terminal, you type in Jupyter-notebook. If you're on Windows or Mac, you have more likely a menu, or Mac you can also use the terminal. On Windows you probably have a menu of different programs, and you just select the Jupyter notebook. Sometimes it's useful to have the browser started before, and then you should come to a page which more or less looks like this. Some kind of list of files in a directory. And if you're starting this in the directory where you have the notebook stored, then you can select this, and just by clicking on it, you can start the notebook. So maybe I'll do this for you, just to so that you can see how it works. Let's stop this. So hopefully you'll be able to get into such a situation where you can just click on the notebook.
Yes.
Then another window will come up. It takes a second until this really gets started, and then you should be able to see these comments and some cells where you can put in code later on. Is this working more or less for most of you? No? What's not working? Where are you stuck? You cannot open it, so that means you get into this page and you see the notebook or you don't see it. Then it's in the wrong directory. You have to, you're on Windows?
Yeah.
You can just drag and drop them there.
Right. Somebody else with major problems?
Does anyone still need the Jupyter notebook? Yes, no?
For installing?
Just for downloading the Jupyter
notebook.
Just
this notebook here. This notebook. Okay. Now, since you have done already this introductory work, probably I don't need to convince you anymore that you should stay in this tutorial, because you have spent so much time on getting prepared that you are going to stay anyway. But nevertheless, maybe I should tell you why NumPy arrays should be interesting at all. Why are you going to spend 3 hours in a tutorial on something? This should be worth it. What's NumPy arrays about? Actually, this morning in the tutorial, you already heard a bit about NumPy, NumPy ints, special data types, and so on. Well, actually, whenever you do scientific work, then you're using NumPy in some way or the other. Actually, Python wasn't mentioned this morning, but at the very end in this morning's tutorial, it was said that there are a lot of components in the standard library. So a lot of things which usually you would like to code are already present. People say Python comes with batteries included. I mean, you know this, on a Saturday you buy this toy and you come home in the evening, you want to try it out, and you realize that there are no batteries and you cannot try it out on Saturday evening or on Sunday. That's of course not nice, and the nice thing about Python is that these batteries are included. All this is for free, NumPy is for free, which is non-trivial for a scientific library. A lot of effort goes in all of these packages, and actually, for people who are interested in that, on Friday there will be what people call a sprint, where you can contribute to packages if you are interested in that. So the question for us as scientists is, what about the batteries for scientists? Are there Bessel functions? Can I do linear algebra and all these kind of things? Can I do image processing? Can I do data analysis? And so on. And well, there's what people call the scientific Python ecosystem, or sometimes the scientific Python stack, which consists mainly of NumPy or at the basis, and then the SciPy library, including the scikits, you might hear about scikit learn, scikit image, and so on, matplotlib, the IPython shell, SymPy, pandas, and some more packages. And all of these packages, when you're using them or when you're attending other tutorials, there will be tutorials on matplotlib, on SciPy tomorrow, on SymPy, pandas as well. all these packages rely basically on the functionality which NumPy provides, namely the NumPy arrays. Well, NumPy provides much more, as you will see, but the most important part are really the NumPy arrays. And so my task during this tutorial is basically to tell you how these NumPy arrays, so-called ND arrays, really work. Now, if you want to do some reading by your own after this tutorial, you want to learn a bit more about all these things and really use them, there are two very important sources. One, the web page with the NumPy tutorial, with the NumPy documentation, which you find here. docs.scipy.org. So you can go to the NumPy reference guide, and here you have a lot of material where you find everything documented which you need to know. So that's a source of information, a very important source of information. And the second quite important source of information are the SciPy lecture notes. And if you look at who contributed, you'll see that quite a few people listed somewhere. For example, Gael and Emmanuel are around here. Emmanuel is the one with the baby, so you'll recognize her. So these people who are doing this work for you, they are actually present. You can talk to them. And if you want, during the sprints, you can contribute to these lecture notes. For the moment, for you, the important point is that in these lecture notes, you find really a lot of material on the Python language, on NumPy, on Matplotlib, SciPy, and so on. So this is a very valuable resource if you really want to use all these tools. Now, what do we want to do? Well, as scientists, we want to work with vectors and matrices. That's the objects we are mostly used to. And if I say scientists, I include you as well, of course, because you might have to do with images, maybe. Right? I don't know, not so much. No? Okay. So maybe you have to do with arrays anyway. What I want to point out here is that, for example, a color image is also an array. I mean, as a mathematician, you might not think about this as an array in the first place, but an image is nothing else, a digital image is nothing else than an array. It's an n times n times 3 array. There's a third direction, red, green, blue. So there's a lot of objects which can really be very well represented as vectors or matrices. Matrices in higher dimensions. If you want, you can use 10-dimensional matrices, but be aware, if you have a 10-dimensional matrix, 1,000 by 1,000 by 1,000 by 1,000, it's going to be very huge. Should fit still in your storage. What we want is that our code runs fast. Some people say that Python tends to be a bit slow. Actually, using NumPy will improve the speed of your code considerably, if you do try it. You would like to have support for linear algebra. You want to be able to calculate eigenvalues or eigenvectors of the matrix or something like that. There are a lot of things we want to do with matrices, and that's really where NumPy comes in. And at that point you might think, well, this morning I've heard about lists, or if you were not in the tutorial this morning, you might have heard about lists anyway. Lists are a means of collecting objects in this list, right? And addressing individual objects in this list. And the main difference between a list, a Python list, and a NumPy array is that in a Python list, you can put arbitrary objects. This morning you have seen that in a list you can have numbers, you can have strings at the same time, or even other lists. So this is a multi-purpose collector and collects anything which you want to put in there. Whereas an array, or the array we are thinking about, is really something homogeneous, where all the data are basically of the same type. And that's where the big advantage lies. That's what we are going to use, and that's what will make things fast in the end. Now there's one similarity or one connection between arrays and lists which I want to discuss here, or remind you of properties of lists. That's the way one indexes individual list elements or slices, which you have seen this morning. So we'll try this out in a second, but let me just remind you of the main points. So suppose you have a list of objects. This is now the standard Python list. It's not about NumPy arrays for the moment, but you will see that for NumPy arrays it works in the same way. And you have objects. You learned this morning that the objects start with index 0, pointers to Fortran. So we start at 0, 1, 2, and so on. And the nice thing in Python is you can number the elements also from the back, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, down to minus n. And then you can also use slices. And whoever attended the tutorial this morning, you might have been maybe a bit surprised that if you write something like that, suppose I have list A from 0, first element, to 5, you might have been surprised that 5 is not included. Okay, now at this point you can learn the last element is not included, which is not very convincing, actually. So think of this in terms of real slices. So this is cut 0, this is cut 1, this is cut 2, 3, 4, 5. And if you cut here, the fifth cut here will be between 4 and 5. Right? And now it's obvious that the slice from 0 to 5 will stop at element 4. Right? It's really a slice. You're not numbering the individual objects in a sense. And the nice thing about it is that you can continue with the same number. You don't have to add one. That's the idea of these slices. Such a slice will contain several pieces of information, the start, the stop, and the step size. So you can step in steps of 2. You can even have negative steps when you go from backwards to forwards. You can leave out these elements if you leave out the start. That means that the slice will start at the beginning. If you leave out stop, it will go all the way until the end. If you leave out the step, then the stepwise by default is 1. But you can control all these parameters. Okay, and that's now the sign. Whenever you see this sign, that's where you have to do something. So you go to your Jupyter notebook. Okay. Let me make this a little bit bigger, I think. Is this readable for everybody, or should I enlarge it even further? Can you read this with the back? Okay. So what you can do is you can click on such a cell. Now, if you have clicked on it, you see this is going to be green. If it's green, it means you can change things. So be aware. So if I start typing here, as soon as the frame is green, you're going to change what's written there. But of course, that's what you're supposed to do as we go on. And now you can just say Shift Enter, and you should get a list. Okay, does that work for everybody? Just Shift Enter. I use Shift Enter because then you get immediately onto the next cell here. So what has happened here? Well, I said range of 10. Range of 10 actually in Python 3 generates you numbers on demand. Generates the numbers from 0 to 9. And list just says put these numbers for me into a list, which I call my list, and I print it, and that's the list from 0 to 9. Okay, now if you click on this, just, I mean, there might be things happening. If you click on this, Then you could change the text here as well, but that's something you probably don't want to do. So just with the shift enter, everything will be fine again. On the next cell, and now it's your task. So for the moment, we have this variable my list, which is this list from 0 to 9, and let's just practice a bit of slicing. So what I would like to ask you is to, in these cells here, fill in the corresponding slicing. Okay? So you should put an expression here, which as the output produces the list which I've indicated here. So let's do the first example together maybe. So you go on this cell, you click on it, you have a green frame, so now you can enter something. You want to do a slice of my list. My list, brackets. And now we want to start at 2. We start at 2. And we want to have 5 included, so we have to cut between 5 and 6. That's the cut number 6. So, 2, 6. That's right. And now I would like to ask you to go to these few examples. I'll give you a couple of minutes. Please try to reproduce the list which I've given there, the 5 remaining examples. If there's any problem, just tell me, and in 1 or 2 minutes, I'll go through these examples and show you how I can. Okay. Between, is there somebody needing any further assistance in setting up things? Several solutions. You could either say, let's start explicitly at 0, or, as I told you, omitting the starting value means we start at 0, so it's sufficient to just say colon 5. But if you say 0 colon 5, it's also fine, it's just more explicit. Then here's 6 and 8, 9. You start at 6 and go to the very end. So I don't need to know how long the list is. That's actually the situation which is much more important. we always know that the list starts at zero, so putting the zero here is easy, but often you don't know how long the list is. Of course, you have seen this morning that you can ask the list, how long are you? But that's unnecessary. In this way, you get the list to its very end. Then this one here, this is basically the full list. I put colon, colon, right? From the beginning to the end in steps of two. And now we're coming to this interesting example backwards. This is minus one. Right? Because minus one is the step, minus one goes backwards, starting at nine, eight, and so on. And then finally, 753, 7, 2, 2, 2, no, sorry. Ah, sorry. Actually, if something like this happens, then you're in this mode to enter this text here. Just hit shift enter and you're fine. If I have step 2, then I of course go forward from the element 7 forward. There's nothing left if I want to go to 2. So I have to go backwards to minus 2. Okay, are there any questions at this point? Very good, because we're going to use the slicing later on in the NumPy arrays a lot. Now, let's for the moment ask, do we really need NumPy arrays? I mean, there's this idea that maybe we can use matrices in this way, that we say, okay, a matrix is a sort of list, right? Could say each row here is a list, and the whole matrix is a list of lists. Right? So I could define a matrix, at least that's something you could imagine. I could define a matrix as a list which starts here and ends here, and which contains the three rows as lists. Right? Okay, so the question is, can we extract a row from this list, and can we extract a column? So, let's see. So I've defined the matrix for you. Now, in order for this to work, you need to execute this cell here. Otherwise, the object matrix is not defined. So we just execute it. And now, let's see. Give you a minute to try to do a slicing in order to extract, let's say, the second row. And see whether we are able to manage. If you finish this fast, then you can try to extract the second column by slicing. Please don't use list comprehensions. We heard this morning about list comprehensions, but don't use them here. Anybody find a solution for the first problem? Or can we get the second row? Any idea? It's the second element, right? And how would you index it?
The way I did it was
yeah.
Matrix 1.
Matrix 1, right? So this works. It's the second row, it's just the second element of the matrix. Now this is sort of asymmetric. If we have matrices in mind, it would sort of be nicer to say, and that's, of course, I mean, your solution is the right one for this, but let me just add this one here. It still works. The idea is, okay, I have a matrix of one, which is the number of the row, and I use all the elements in this list. I just write down this explicitly at this point. You would never do this with lists in this way, but let me do this just to make the point of a matrix, I mean making rows and columns more symmetric. Now, given that, you might think that you could get a column in the following way. It's a stupid idea, but I mean, why not try it? I mean, interchange rows and columns, right? What happens? You get the same thing. Can we understand this? Of course we can. I mean, Python doesn't do something just out of fun. It's doing this for a good reason. So what is matrix colon? Well, colon means everything from the beginning to the end. So, well, this is like a pass taken this morning. It doesn't do anything. It just returns the full list, right? And then, as you said, index number one tells us out of this full object here, I get the element number two. So I'm back to the second row. So I don't get columns out easily. And that already tells you that there's something wrong with lists of lists. They don't really go for matrices. You cannot access a column easily. You can do this with list comprehensions if you want, but I mean, that's completely asymmetric. I mean, as a scientist, you would never accept doing something as asymmetric as one would need to do here. Okay, so we can extract a row easily, but we cannot extract a column, and that means lists of lists just do not look like matrices. They are not good matrices. So, what are the problems? Well, we have seen that different axes cannot be treated on equal footing. There was the problem that lists can contain arbitrary objects, and this typically makes lists slow, because Python never knows where the next object comes from. It has ways to look it up, of course. But it's not that it knows that every eighth byte or so there is the next object. It really has to do some lookup to do that. List elements can be actually scattered in memory, so it's not like Python could just go through the memory and operate on the elements. So all these are points which make lists relatively slow. And we said we want to do our computation fast. In science, we often have problems which need some computing time, and it makes a difference, in particular if you need to finish your master thesis within a few months, then it's important that your program runs fast enough. But even more important, if you think in terms of matrices, lists are conceptually inappropriate. Yeah, let's see this asymmetry between row and column, and they have much less performance than possible for these reasons. So we have to do something better, and what is better? That's the ND array. ND array is basically short for n-dimensional array or multi-dimensional array. So this is an array of homogeneous objects, all the same, all floats, all integers, or whatever, even strings, of fixed size items. All these integers, all these floats, or all these strings, experiment with that in a minute, are all of the same size. So, we have seen this morning that sometimes you have to import something into Python, and there are actually different ways to import a package. Often people do the following, don't do this now, because I don't recommend this. So what often people do, for example, if you import the math module, want to use sine, cosine, tangent, and whatever, people do this actually, from math import star. The problem is that you import all symbols out of this package. And this can be pretty bad if this is a huge package and you have lots of symbols. In particular, it will turn out that this NumPy package, for example, contains its own sine function and cosine function. Now suppose you import from math everything and from NumPy everything. Then you ask yourself, what is the sine actually? Is it the sine from the math library or from the NumPy library? And here with NumPy, you really get lots of symbols. So don't do that. So the other option would be to say, okay, I need arrays, I need sine, cosine. That's fine, but in reality, it's not very practical if you need lots of functions out of this library. So you don't want to have a long list of such objects here. So that's what you typically don't do. Then the option would be to take NumPy. This forces you at every point where you use a NumPy function to say NumPy dot something, which is annoying. Well, it's nice because you say this comes from NumPy. It's clear this sine function or cosine comes from NumPy. But still you have to type NumPy, which is a bit long. It's 5 characters, so let's make it to 2. Why? Because everybody does it this way. If you see NP in your program, you can be 99.9% sure that somebody has imported NumPy as NP, and NP actually is something out of the NumPy. So I really recommend that you do this. Then in your code you see whenever there's an NP, you know this is from NumPy. You know where it comes from, but it's not as lengthy as NumPy because sometimes the equations we are coding are already pretty long. So what you need to do, and that's your job again, in your notebook so that you have access to NumPy, please import NumPy in precisely this way, import NumPy as NP. I'm going to do this here as well. Okay, and now we are ready to write with NumPy. Now, I already told you that in NumPy, arrays are homogeneous, so they have all the same types of objects, and this can be actually all kinds of Python objects. Integers, floats, complex numbers, booleans, even strings. By default, it's the Python floats. Now, this morning, you very quickly heard about NumPy integers. Now, of course, if you're just using Python, this is not standard to use NumPy integers. And I want to tell you something about Python integers, which wasn't said this morning. Python integers can be arbitrarily long. So, I can do that. Could add another zero. At some point my computer will be blocked because it's doing computations, but in principle, integers in Python can be arbitrarily large. And the problem is, if you get used to that, this is very nice. But at some point, when you're going to NumPy, you might get bitten by the fact that the integers in NumPy are really types which you have in C, the programming language C. So that means that integers can be as large as 64-bit, but not larger. And that means that if you're used to having arbitrarily large integers, and you use NumPy arrays, that all of a sudden, well, it's no longer true that integers can be arbitrarily large. So, beware of overflows. We'll take a look at an example. Now, in order to try these types out, let's take a look at how we can create NumPy arrays. So, one thing you can use in NumPy in order to look up the documentation, so you can use the lookfor function. In lookfor, create array. Let's try this. See, you get a whole list of ways to create arrays. More than you really need. Luckily, what you're really looking for is what is written here at the very top, numpy.array, allows us to create an array. That's really what we want to use. And we want, if we want to have more information on how to create an array, let's just ask for help. This morning you saw doc strings. These are precisely these doc strings which have been mentioned this morning, which we're going to use here. And here it says, okay, we create an array from an object, an array-like object. What is an array-like object? That could be a list or a list of lists. We're taking a look at that in a second. You see that there are some other variables here, and remember this morning in the tutorial, you learned that these are default values. So you see, there are some possibilities to, for example, influence the type of the variables, the so-called D-type, the data type, and this is set to none. So you can override it, you can say, I want to have a float, or I want to have a complex number. If you don't do it, then NumPy will look at this value none and will do the proper action for you. The default is to choose a float array. There are some more possibilities here to change the behavior, which are in practice not that important. So what we have is a matrix, or matrix, remember, this list of lists here, which we can now use to produce an array. So all we need to do is to say np.array of matrix. And while this still looks a bit like a list of a list, it really is an array. This is now a multi-dimensional array, an ND array. If you don't believe me, just ask for the type. So this morning, and you see, it's indeed a NumPy ND array. Actually, a very convenient way, if you're practicing, is to produce arrays in this way by means of A range. A range is a little bit like the range you know from Python. Gives you numbers, A range from, of 6 from 0 to 5. And that's very convenient if you have an array where the elements are numbered in the sequence. Then you know exactly what's happening. So we are going to use this later on. So let me create such an array. That's precisely what we expect. An array from 0 to 5. Okay, and now let's look at the attributes. I've written here a function. The details are really not that important, but this function will help us to learn more about the matrices. So we just define this function. And now we can ask for the attributes of the array which we have created. So we have this array with elements 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And these are the properties of this array. What do these properties mean? Well, the dimension of the array is 1. It's a one-dimensional array. The size is 6, there are 6 items. Each item has the size of 8 bytes. That's pretty clear because the type, the data type is int 64, 64 bits for the integer. A byte has 8 bits, so the item size is 8. The shape, which we will discuss later on in more detail, is 6, which just means this is a tuple, which tells you how many elements are there in each direction. Now this is a one-dimensional array, so there's just one size, and that's 6 elements. And the strides are 8. What are the strides? The strides is the following. You have the array, so suppose the array is here, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And I'm now Python. I'm playing the role of Python. So I'm standing here at the beginning of the array. The question is, how far do I have to go in order to be at the next element. And the stride tells me how far do I have to go. It's the step I have to make, which is 8. Because this object, at the cell number 0, has the size 8 bytes. Right? And then I walk another 8 bytes, and then I'm at the second element, and so on. So the strides tell me how I walk through this data. And that's all what I need to know about this. You'll see, this becomes more interesting. I don't know whether everybody could hear this. The question was, what's the difference between the strides and the item size? And this is a good question, because in 1D, this is basically the same. Well, actually, I could change the strides here if I would, for example, change the strides to 16 instead of 8. What would that mean? The item sizes are still 8, but I tell Python, go in steps of 16, a large stride. Then I go 2 objects.
You can enforce.
You can, right, you can change the step size, basically. Right? And you could even play dirty tricks. You can say the strides is 4. And then you get nonsense, right? Because you go in the middle of an object. You just go to somewhere in the memory. So this is dangerous, but we'll see. I mean, we are going to use this. We are not going to use it that much explicitly, but you can do a lot of interesting things. And in the end, in the slicing, that's what's used. So there is actually a difference, which becomes more important if you have multi-dimensional. Are there more questions at this point? We're not asking any questions so far. So, trivial or?
I created a matrix.
Yeah.
Which. Is that a different with an ND already? Or is it something else?
You mean a matrix here in the NumPy matrix? Or?
Yes. ND got the event, and then I got the matrix.
What did you do? Gives you random variables. I will use the markup rule. We are going to use random values later on in just standard arrays. That's really much better. Okay, now so far,
So in my case, the D-type is only int 32, so is this just belonging to the system that I'm using? Or
no, int is fine. It's only saying int.
I only have half of the size, so for example, in my case, then the strides are 4, because you have 64.
You may be on a 32-bit machine. This is somewhat older laptop.
Maybe then I installed just the wrong version of. So, but that
could be that your standard size is 30. Are you using Python 3 or Python 2?
Python 3. And I have a 64-bit system, so.
This is a bit surprising.
But it must be the same.
You can, if you really have this problem, you can explicitly state with D-type that you want to have.
This you can do, but by standard.
However, just wondering because why the default size here is different. But,
yeah, I'm a bit surprised because I would have expected on the Python 3 64-bit computer that you get in 64 as default if you start out from int array as you did.
No,
I'm not completely sure what the reason is.
Okay, yeah.
But I mean, let's play around a little bit with data types. I'd like to ask you just to try out different data types like floats, complex numbers, booleans, strings. What you do is you just create a list, or if you want a list of lists, you use an NP-array to produce an array, and you check its D-type. You can either use this array attributes, which I've used here, or if you want, you can also say that this array, my array 1, you can just say dot dtype. And say, see that this is in 64. So So just try this out for some floats, for complex numbers, booleans, and strings. The most interesting will be the strings one. Use strings of different sizes, like Python and EuroSci-Pi and other. Just that you see that you can create all kinds of different data frames. It's sufficient to have small lists, you don't need to produce large matrices at this point. So, just some examples here. That complex numbers, of course, need twice as much memory as floats, 64 times 2 is 128, because there's a real and imaginary part. Boolean, maybe most interesting. You see that you just get the float, 64, the complex 128, and Boolean. Now, in the last case, in principle, it doesn't look as homogeneous as we assumed an array to be, because these strings have different length. So what Python does at this point is, well, U is a Unicode character, it just looks at the longest string, which is EuroSciPy, which contains 9 characters. So every entry now has the size of 9 characters. Even if in some cases, like Python, we would only need 6 characters, but every object now has the same size. Now, let's do something interesting. Might be your prize here. A range from 1 to 160 in steps of 10, and we use as a D type int 8. Just try out what this results in. Do you understand what's going on here? Because the standard size on a 64-bit computer should be float 64. The 64-bit is the standard. I mean, actually, most computations, there's no reason to use smaller sizes. Actually, in the old days, when I started doing computations in science, we had this, all the floats. So you could go up to, how much was it, 10 to the 30 or something like that. And we were looking for the double variables which were longer, like the float 64. So actually what in scientific calculations you usually need are 64-bit floats. So that's really the standard, and you shouldn't go to small numbers unless there's a good reason to do that. because otherwise what's happening here might happen. So what's going on here? Why do we get negative values?
One digit from sign on the 7th
number itself. Yes. 2 to the power 7
is 128. So all numbers
above
that start from minus.
Right. So we have an overflow. We are not told about it at this point, and we just start at the other end again. So that's what I was saying here. Beware of overflows. So if you think that integers in Python is no problem at all because they can be arbitrarily large, well, if you just are willing to invest 8 bits here in this case, then you will overflow easily. But actually, integers in NumPy cannot be arbitrarily large, maximum 64 bits, which is more than sufficient because up to 10 to the 308, that should really be enough. But well, you have to be careful here.
Yeah. What is the type of old? It's not here, I just type it now.
Yeah. Okay. What was the data type
name? The last old. Just
good question.
So I'm just trying now.
Okay. It's just a Python object, okay? So just so that everybody can see it. Yeah, it's a Python object. So this is actually, I mean, you could put in whatever you like, but at some point, there is no basically C-based representation anymore. So then somehow this object has to be short. But then this is, I mean, whenever you can do this, I would say that you're probably misusing NumPy arrays and that it's much more likely that you would use better this for that function.
When we mix up CSVs and so
try it out.
Yeah.
I mean, basically, it's then you're still at O because that's basically where you can represent all these elements.
Already now here, so
yeah.
Without sound, so
oh, then you have this would be this example, right?
And string and a number.
And a number.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
yeah, let's try it out. So actually, I wouldn't have known the answer right away, but apparently the 3.1 for one is converted to a Unicode. But I mean, these are really not the situations where you would want to use arrays. Unless you, well, for specific purposes, yes, but that's not difficult. There are more questions at this point. Then let's get a bit more into strides. I mean, the question before was, what's the point about strides? If 8, the number of strides, or the size of the strides, is just the size of the object. That, well, there's no good reason for that. But suppose you have an array. Instead of this one-dimensional array, 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you have the 2D array, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then strides are used in the following way. Tuple 24A, which means that if you are walking in this direction, you are walking in a stride of 8 from object to object. And if you are walking downwards here, then you are walking in strides of 24. Okay? So that means that in memory we have precisely the same thing, but we are looking at it in a different way. this is maybe one of the most important things to note here. That's if you rearrange these matrix elements, if you produce a 2D array out of 1D array, also in this space here, where vertically becoming steps of 16 in this 3x2 matrix, it's always the same thing in memory, because in memory this has to be one-dimensional basically, right? There's nothing like 2 or 3 or 10 dimensions in memory. So you have a piece of storage where all your matrix elements are, and the difference between these different matrices is just the way Python interprets the indices, how it accesses objects. Why is this important? The point is, whenever you copy data in memory, it will cost you time. So whenever in NumPy you're doing something where you're creating a new array, it will cost you time. Scientists, you don't have time to do this. You want to run your program fast, so want to try as much as possible. Of course, this is not possible throughout the whole program, but you want to use the data as they are, if possible. And the strides are a way to integrate the data in a different way, to have a different view on your arrays. That's an important concept. So for the sake of efficiency, NumPy uses views if possible. Of course, that to some extent depends also on you as a programmer. So changing one or more matrix elements in one matrix will change it in all views. So if I change here the first element, replace 0 by 42, let's say, then this will be changed in all these matrices as well, because it's always the same data we're looking at.
The strides are a specialty of 2D arrays?
No, you can also have them in 10D. Okay. But then it's a tuple of 10 entries, and it tells you, depending in which direction you want to go, that's an element in the tuple, how far you have to go. And this is not at all 2D. It's in 3D. Let's just do an example. So if I take NP arrange, I haven't explained tree shape yet, but what this does, see it here, we are going to take a more detailed look at this example later, but what this does is basically produces out of the array 0 to 23, this 1D array, a three-dimensional array with dimension 2, 3, and 4. Okay? And now let's look at the strides. So you now see the strides are 8, 32, and 96. This way basically Python or NumPy just takes the indices of the elements you want to access, multiplies with the respective strides, and adds everything up and knows exactly the position in memory where this element lies. Okay, one example which we are going to look at in a second in the examples is, for example, the transposition of a matrix. So if you have a matrix and you want to look at the transpose, that means you mirror the matrix at its diagonal, then you can understand this just as a new U on the same data. There's no need to create a new array. That's important. So let's play around with that. So we had, just to remind you, how my array one looked like. That was this one-dimensional array, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we can do a reshape. A reshape now does exactly what I've shown you here. Takes this array and reshapes it. In a 2x3 matrix. 2 is basically up down and 3 is horizontal. So these are the same data in memory but interpreted differently. So if I look at the array attributes, then we see that the strides are, as I've shown you before, 24 and 8. And I can also produce this other matrix. Show you how it looks like. This matrix. And the only difference is that the strides are different. That's the secret of a view of how you can access or interpret data in memory differently. Okay, now let's see what this implies. I already mentioned that if now you change an element in this chunk of memory, you're changing all views. So if now I say my array one, of 0, this was a one-dimensional array, is 42. Let's take a look at my array 1. By the way, just created a new cell. How do you create a new cell? If you're on a cell in blue, in green, you can enter something. You can turn it blue so that you can't enter anything anymore. You just hit escape and it comes blue. And then you can type B for bottom or below. So it will create a cell below. A will create a cell above. And you see that, of course, that's no surprise. Element 0 is replaced by 42. But what happened to my array 2? That's the one we had reshaped. Well, of course, since this is the view on the same data, we have changed this as well. So reshape just produces a different view, doesn't produce a new array.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
Does it also work the other way around? If I change array 2, does it also modify array 1?
I don't. So let's correct this mistake here, if you consider it as a mistake. Now we haven't learned yet how to access this element, but let's see. Let's look at my array 2 and my array 1. This is my array 2 and my array 1. Yeah. So, yes, it is really the same data. So basically you could think of that just the interface which does the calculation of where to look at elements up has changed, but the data are really the same. Now if you want to transpose something, let's just create an array and transpose it. So here what I do is I produce a one-dimensional array from 0 to 8. I reshape it in a 3x3 matrix. And it's transposed, looks like this. And this is again a view on the same data.
How could I copy it to a different data?
There are different ways. for example, you could do it very explicitly this way. So, right now, so far you don't believe me that I really have made a copy. So let's change an element. B of 0. Now we are in the two-dimensional. It's 1999. So let's take a look at B. Okay. Oops. No, sorry. That's wrong. That works for lists, it doesn't work for
an explicit copy.
There's also a copy, yeah. I thought. Still have to do computation in addition. But that's actually important. So the copy works in any case. But you're right, and that's an important point. If you do computations with matrices, you add them up, you multiply them, you always create new matrices. That's not working with the views.
So the conjugate of matrix is not considered as an operation, but it's just a thing to do.
This just changes the view. But this is in fact something where people are working on it. Most recent views, there are some, in most recent versions of NumPy, there are some advances in this sense. So NumPy tries to analyze the operations which it's supposed to do and tries to optimize them. There is actually a package called NumExpr, which allows you to give a string of an operation. So you have a plus b times c or something, give this as a string to NumExpr, expert, it will sort of compile this for you and try to do it in an optimized way. To produce as small a number as possible of really new matrices being produced. Now, let me look at this at the strides. So this was our original matrix. Since each element has to be size 8, we have strides of 8. And then since there are 3 elements in a row, we can come to the next row by a stride of 24. And if you look at the strides from the transpose, it's just the other way around. That means walking in the direction 1 is 24. So that brings me from 0 to 3. Whereas walking in the other direction, in this direction 0, has stride of 8, and that just means that these elements are mirrored with respect to the body. So we have this important concept of use. I think before the break, we can talk a little bit about how to produce more interesting arrays. A few interesting routines which are used all the time. A range, hint space, log space, zeros, ones, type, I, rank, and rank int. At this point, and that's really important, we heard this morning about the append method. So you can add a list to a list, elements to a list by using append. You can have a list, you can say append some element. Don't use append in Numpy if you can avoid. There is the append method, and you might think that that's also the usual way to produce arrays. But whenever you add an element to an array, you produce a new array. And I told you, producing new arrays is expensive. So if you produce an array with 1 million elements, one element at a time, this will take a long time. So really avoid appends. If possible, you should at the beginning know how big your arrays are going to be. And then you use this space and you fill it with your data and you work with it. Try to avoid append. So that's another important aspect where arrays differ from this. Even though this morning was said that it would be better to use these comprehensions anyway, but often you end up doing append, and here it would be terrible for your performance. So let's take a look at these creation routines. So A range, that's something we have already looked at, or have already used it. This is a generalization of the usual range. It produces an array, in this case starting at 5, going up to but excluding 50 in steps of 5. So the 30 is not in here. But it's more general. It allows you to also work with floats. So can you try to produce this array here by using A range, but now for floats? There's actually one tricky point. Okay, this is fine because 1.5 is not in the list. But there's actually, here you can fall in the trap of floating errors. So sometimes you might have an element in there which you don't want to have there. So could use 1.6, and then you see 1.6 is in there. So that's actually a bit tricky. That's a matter of rounding errors. So this would work, but it's not very nice. Actually, what I in practice use much more often is linspace, which works slightly different. So linspace does the following. It takes a start value, a stop value, and the number of elements. Can you try to produce this array here with linspace? And P of linspace. I have to choose the start, the stop. The stop is included. One tricky point though. So, how many elements do you need? Not 10, 11, right? Because of the properties. If you use 10, then of course, so 1.5 to 11. because it's really the number of points, not the number of intervals. Number of intervals is 10, number of points is 11. Then there's also log space, which is interesting if you work on a logarithmic scale, for example from minus 2 to 2, steps of 5. So I'm going from 10 to the minus 2 to 10 to the 2 in steps of 5, equally sized intervals on a logarithmic scale. That means I'm 10 to the minus 2, 10 to the minus 1, 1, 10 to the 1, and 10 to the 2. And you can also use other bases, for example the base is 2, and you get 1 square root of 2, 2, 2 times square root of 2, and so on. This is particularly useful if you're creating data in order to produce a graphic representation. Okay, we are almost at the end of the first part. Maybe as an application, let's briefly take a look at some graphic representation. There's something nice at the end of the first part. In order to do that, we import from matplotlib, the pyplot module, we import it as PLT. That's the way everybody does it, so better adhere to the standards, because then everybody knows what you're doing. For matplotlib, there will be an extra tutorial tomorrow. We can produce the output directly here in the notebook by using this directive here, matplotlib inline. And then, as an example, we say, okay, let's take array X, which contains the arguments and the hint space from 0 to 10 in 100 elements, and let's calculate the cosine. So, important point here, what happens here? I have an array of 100 values, and now if I take the cosine from NumPy, I can give it an array, and it will do the calculation for all elements in this array and produce another array. No need to write a loop. It's very short. See that NumPy can help you to write readable code. Yeah? You don't see that this is really an array here. Yeah? There's no loop, nothing. Much easier. So let's do this. Then we plot it. Get this nice plot of a cosine. Now, you might say, oh, plot of a cosine is really not that exciting. So at this point, I invite you to come to the second part of the tutorial, where we have some more graphics, which is maybe more exciting than this cosine.